Good evening, I'm Linda Laurel. Welcome to Red, White, and Blue. In April, Houston Chronicle columnist Lisa Falkenberg was awarded the 2015 Pulitzer Prize for Commentary. Since 1917, the Pulitzer has been one of the highest achievements in American newspaper and online journalism. This year, Falkenberg was one of only 14 recipients of this prestigious award. She was acknowledged for her 10-column series of reports on what she noted as a corrupt and abusive Texas grand jury system. So tonight we ask, what is the state of the Texas grand jury system? What did she uncover in her reporting? And will new policies now be implemented within the Texas legal system? To help guide us through this discussion, we are very pleased to welcome Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Lisa Falkenberg. And leading our discussion, as always, our hosts David Jones and Gary Polland.
Well, thank you, Linda. And Lisa, first I want to say congratulations on winning. I know it's very exciting for you and your family
to get that distinguished
award.
And you are actually our third Pulitzer Prize winner to be on the show.
Who's third?
Our third. You know, third, but you're first in our hearts. You know, you're the only local we've had.
Sure, I thought it was special.
So, Lisa, how in the world did you win this award? What was the process by which the Chronicle thought that you would be worthy of winning a Pulitzer, and what did they do to help you out?
Well, they really helped me out, let me tell you. They made all kinds of calls. They hired a lobbyist.
That's not true.
I'm told some papers actually do have lobbyists.
Wow.
Some form of lobbyists. Last year, you may know, David, I was a finalist as well. And I think that was the first time that the paper had ever entered my columns. And so last year was the year that I was really shocked that I could even be considered at that level when you're competing against the best columnists in the country. This year, I have to say there was a lot of... There was a lot of pressure once I started writing the series on Alfred Dwayne Brown and the grand jury. Some of my colleagues would come in and say, you know, you might have another chance this year at the Pulitzer. And then toward the end, they were saying, you better win it. And so I felt a lot of pressure. The editors at the Chronicle have been really supportive of this kind of work. Not everybody would support a Metro columnist who's supposed to write about lots of different things, education one day, and, you know, death penalty and politics and Austin, and then to spend this much time on a subject that, let's face it, most people don't even know what a grand jury is, what they do. It's not the most interesting thing in the world. And so I think that this year, I do believe that I did some good journalism, and my colleagues have done great journalism on the grand jury system. But the stars kind of aligned on this, because this year people cared about the grand jury. There was a lot of education on what the grand jury was. There was a lot of strife and controversy and protest regarding grand juries.
Tell you did a series. It was 10 columns. Tell us what the columns were about.
Okay. And most of them were about the case of Alfred Dwayne Brown, who was a man convicted of killing a Houston police officer during a burglary. And he had always maintained his innocence. I first got a tip that there was an interesting story in that some... records had been found that substantiated his alibi. They were found years after he had been convicted and sentenced to death.
In the garage of a police officer.
Right, in the homicide detective who investigated the case. And to the DA's credit, former DA Mike Anderson had, quickly turned over the evidence to the appellate attorneys working on the case, and they found the information. The DA agreed to a new trial. The judge agreed to a new trial. They sent it up to the people in Austin, the Court of Criminal Appeals, and they sat on it. That's when I got involved. I said, hey, stop sitting on it. But there was a question. It was nearly a year that they had not done anything on the case. And then the question just kind of burned in my mind. Why a girlfriend who had initially been an alibi witness decided to testify against this man at his trial. And I wanted to know what could have made her change. That's when I went to the courthouse. I looked through a file, some this thick, and the last thing I picked up was a transcript. Now, you never expect to be holding in your hands a transcript
from a grand jury
that says grand jury.
Wow. Yes.
And I kind of looked both ways to make sure, you know, the clerks weren't coming after me. But, you know, this was supposed to be in the file. It was something that the writ attorneys, I believe, put in there because they were so appalled by it. And so what it was an exchange that this woman, the girlfriend, had had with the grand jury in which she was telling one story. They were convinced she was lying, and they threatened throughout to, you know, make sure she never got a job again, take away her kids, lock her up, and charge her with perjury if she didn't tell the story that they wanted.
And she ended up going to jail for perjury.
Yes, even after she changed her story somewhat, they locked her up for 4 months. Another grand jury indicted her for perjury, locked her up for 4 months away from her children. And the most remarkable thing is when she got out, she had all these kind of stipulations, leg monitor and, you know, curfew. But she had to report, I believe it was once a week, to a homicide detective in the case. Now, why would that be? So that she could get her story straight and tell that story.
So was this in the same court which had granted the mistrial or granted the new trial? I think it was a different court. It was a different court where she was accused of perjury and convicted of perjury.
Well, she wasn't convicted. Well, let me think.
She ended
up getting deferred, I think, deferred adjudication. And one of the charges was dismissed, as I recall. But, the case of Alfred Dwayne Brown was in Mark Ken Ellis's court, and it remains there.
And will there be a new trial in that case?
Well, that's what. So last year, the conviction did end up being overturned. I'm not taking credit for that. Happened right after Election Day, as you would think, but
Well, that's when the courts of appeals usually make controversial decisions.
So they save it for that. They overturned the conviction, and you know, when I started this case, I didn't know whether this guy was innocent or guilty. I was concerned that a law had been broken, the prosecutors didn't do their job correctly, and I wanted to see him at least retried. As it went on, and I discovered other things about the case, I came to the conclusion that this man is very likely innocent. And so I went from telling the justices to give him a new trial to telling Devin Anderson, suggesting to Devin Anderson that she, the DA, that she not retry him, that she study the facts very carefully, as she said she would, study them carefully to decide whether to retry. Now, I've been concerned about how long it's taking for them to make that decision. Brown has been transferred to death row, but he's still sitting in the Harris County Jail waiting for some decision. It's been nearly 6 months, and the prosecutor on the case.
Did you put grand jury reform on the agenda of the Texas legislature, do you believe, with all of these columns?
I'd like to think so. Yeah, I don't think I can take credit for the overturning of Brown's conviction, but I'd like to take, you know, some credit for journalism being the reason that lawmakers got serious about this issue and saw it as something that could be done. For years, you know, people in Houston, Johnny Mata and other people have, decades, have been sounding the alarm about Texas's system, our pick-a-pal grand jury system, in which we allow judges to pick friends, acquaintances as commissioners, and then they pick people they believe could be good grand jurors. Often these end up being friends. Often they are good grand juries. People are doing what they are doing the right thing in our system, but often I believe they're not. And so this is, the U.S. Supreme Court has said that the Texas system is vulnerable to abuse, but few instances in the past have there been actual proof, black and white, you know, and in this case, lawmakers could read one of my first columns on this and see quoted verbatim what went on in that grand jury room. And I think when they saw that, it was no longer a bunch of activists yelling. It was no longer, you know, just a suggestion that our system could be used for bad, could be corrupted. But it was a bit of proof that they needed to see to go forward with the reform.
And we're optimistic that the legislature will pass some kind of reform, at least for the big counties this time.
Do you have any news for us on that?
Well, it did hit a stumbling block, and it looked like it might be dead. But, you know, some of the lawmakers in the Houston delegation worked together, and Representative Harold Dutton's bill has progressed and is now on the Senate side, where the sponsor on the Senate, Senator John Whitmire, has worked to get it out of committee, and now it's got to make it through the Senate again, which the Senate had approved it unanimously. Then it's got to go back over to the House. The sticking point will be that an amendment was tacked on to make it only apply to jurisdictions with 500,000 people or more. Now, the problem I have with that is that, you know, why do you get The reform, I should say, is for us to pick our grand juries the way that we pick our trial juries, randomly, mostly randomly. There's a few exceptions in there. But why would we have that fair system that every other state in the union has and the federal government's had since 68 in a major metropolitan area, but in the small towns and counties, we have something different where the good old boy system is still in effect? That doesn't make any sense.
But the Chronicle submitted other of your columns to the Pulitzer Committee, did they
right.
not?
Mm-hmm.
And tell us about how you found Mrs. Troth, who is the poster child for the abuse of photo ID.
Well, Mrs. Troth is a very, you know, she's a very interesting woman, very determined. And I think it was actually Senator Whitmire who called me and said, look, I had this lady call and curse me out. Now, Mrs. Troth is a very good Christian. And in fact, everybody she meets, she makes these handmade crosses that I still carry in one of my coats. But so I will not say she cursed him out, but she was quite upset
strong.
That she had tried to go, her daughters had taken her to the DPS office to try and get a voter ID so that she could vote, and she was not able to. And she wanted to know why lawmakers had changed the law and why she was having so much difficulty. She called Senator Whitmire, and he had to tell her, ma'am, I didn't vote for that. But he thought that her story needed to get out there, and I agreed with him after talking with her, going with her to the DPS office.
I don't remember you suggesting that the motive for the photo ID bill had more to do with restricting Hispanic voters who allegedly were committing fraud and who were coming across the border and invading our electoral system and such things as that. Is that what you think?
No, I don't think that was what it was about.
That's in David's mind.
No, that was in the column. I know, but you know, nobody was. I don't believe the legislature passed photo ID, in order to restrict 80-year-old white women from voting.
No, and actually,
I think they did it to restrict anyone's voting. David, it was just to end potential fraud. I know that's what you believe.
Yeah. Well, I'm wanting to know what the columnist believes.
That's his columnist.
You know, David, I have to say, I was glad that Laura Troth was white. I was. Because I think that in certain, you know, certain people have tried to make this into, well, they've assumed that the people who would be affected by it or could have trouble figuring this new system out are non-white. And there's been a lot of criticism there. Oh, well, if those minorities can't figure it out, well, here's a woman who, you know, born and raised in this country, white. She doesn't fit the profile of a newcomer or, you know, somebody who doesn't speak English well enough to figure out the system. She's just an older woman who's changed names a few times. I'm trying to remember what her issues were. But, you know, a lot of older citizens are having problems getting the documents in order, especially women who have the name added.
Yes, so they need to make it simpler so folks can get their photos and so they can have IDs, which are helpful. But I want to ask you another question, Lisa. You're a columnist.
Right.
Okay. Tell the viewers what's the difference between being a columnist for a major newspaper and being a reporter.
Yeah, I'm still trying to figure that out, but no.
As you understand it.
No, I'm still trying to figure out what the definition of this job that I have. The harder question really is what's the difference between an editorial writer and a Metro columnist? But no, I mean, as a reporter, you report the facts. You try to get all of the sides of a story. I tend to be reporter heavy just because that's what I enjoy. Some columns, you know, I do a lot more reporting than others. But a columnist allows me to take what I've learned, to do my homework. It doesn't excuse me from doing my homework. Do my homework. Come away from it and decide what is the right course of action here. You know, what perspective do I want to shine a light on? Sometimes it's not me. Sometimes it's somebody that I've talked to, a teacher, a principal, who I think has a perspective that I want to share.
Well, that means,
but usually there's opinion, there's a viewpoint.
That means you're letting other people give their opinions rather than you give yours.
Sometimes. Most of the time it's mine.
That's if she agrees with it, of course. It's an opinion that makes sense to you.
Yeah, I'm trying to think.
There are a few people
I've focused on that I don't necessarily agree with, but...
Do you make that clear in your column when you do that? But I'm not buying it.
One you agreed with was your housekeeper, who benefited from the Obama executive order.
Mm-hmm. Well, hadn't yet, but
yes.
May someday.
So there you are in a roundabout way giving an opinion about your support for that executive order.
Right. I think another thing a columnist does is try to bring a human a human story to an issue that maybe seems distant and political and just kind of tainted with all the talking points and the rhetoric. And here's a woman who comes in my house, you know, who plays with my kids, who scrubs my bathroom, and she's a real person, and she's got her own kids, and she needs to have a chance in this country, in my opinion. I felt that telling that story might illustrate what's at stake in this issue for some people who may not see it. Now, I got, you know, a lot of angry email in response to that. I got a lot of positive email, but it's a story that I felt like I had to be.
And you understand the other perspective, and I think, you know,
now
it's
what
helpful.
Is it, Gary?
Well, I'm going to tell you. Really, what I was going to say that you do have the case of your housekeeper, who's a nice lady, who adds to the country, and I'm sure you think she adds value to your life, and that's a positive. I think the concern of people that are concerned about the Obama reform is we've been down this road before, and we're told, well, we got all these people here, and if they're law abiding, they should stay. And we did it. And then we said, and then we're going to control the border, so in the future we'll actually have an immigration system based on some sense of public policy. And it didn't happen. Uh-huh. And so the concern is we're going to do the same thing again. So I really do think the numbers would shift considerably in favor of the position you take if we actually knew we were going to control our border and had a workable immigration system, a legal immigration system that made sense. And then take care of the people that are here. I think that's the perspective from
that's
the other side.
That's a Fox perspective.
Well, no, I mean, I agree with you on reform. We need to have a system that works. The system is broken right now.
It has been
so
forever.
The question is whether or not these people just live in some kind of purgatory while the people in Washington fight over what to do about the system. The fact is the system isn't fair. I mean, should these people who've been here a while, followed the law, you know, honest citizens honest members of our community
residents.
Who contribute, residents, there you go, you know, should they live in fear every day of their lives?
Well, and I think it also sets up a situation for them where they can be exploited, which is a bad thing.
You're right about that.
But
I think we both think
yeah,
there needs to
federal
be reform.
Federal government has totally failed to have a workable immigration law or enforce the laws we had. So you can really have a national conversation, because I really do believe the numbers will be off the charts in terms of, let's say we're controlling our borders, we actually know who's here, now we're going to take care of the law-abiding residents that are here. I think the numbers would be 85 or 90% saying, yeah, let's do that.
I'm sure you're not surprised to hear that Mr. Steinberg, who was here recently, has numbers on our local opinions about path to citizenship and the
Kleinberg?
Like, and they're very high. Stephen uh-huh. Kleinberg, right?
Houston, sir.
You know, in other words, Houston is very supportive of immigrants and supportive of them being able to live here uh-huh. decently and get out of the shadows. That's the numbers that came out of Kleinberg's uh-huh. research.
Right.
Interesting. I have another question for you. Does the Houston Chronicle tell you what to write about in your column?
That's funny. So many people ask me that. No. I mean, maybe that goes on in some papers, but no one ever. I mean, every now and then, you know, an editor shuffles in with a bad editor idea. No offense to my editors. Every now and then it's a good editor idea. But for the most part, they let me go. Now, I will say that the only column I've had where they absolutely would not publish, and that was my tweet on it, column that the Houston Chronicle would not publish, was written in iambic pentameter. It was a poem that was a spoof on an ode to Rick Perry now I can't remember the name of the member who wrote it, but a member had written this glowing, you know, the Patriot of Paint Creek poem that was said to be one of the worst poems in the English language by some. And so I wrote the second worst poem in the English language, and they wouldn't publish it. I guess I'm not a poet.
I guess they want you to be humorous. I don't know.
Lisa, does Dan Patrick return your phone calls?
You know, I hadn't called him lately. He used to. I don't think he's called.
When did he stop?
I wrote one about, what is the Texas Common Core? I forget the name of that thing. The
educational thing?
Yeah. I wrote one about an issue that he agreed with me on. It's a curriculum that is, you know, produced in Texas that had become kind of the Texas Common Core. I can't believe I can't remember that name. But anyway, I think that was the last time that we really talked. And then after that, I've called, you know, his Alan Blakemore, and when he was running, and never heard back from
Well, when he was running, he didn't come to the Chronicle to interview with anyone.
Yeah, but he came on our show.
I don't remember. I'm not on the editorial board, so I don't know if he came.
In fact, editorial board, I wanted to ask you about that.
Why? I'm not on the editorial board.
I'll ask you a question. Why is it from time to time we will see things you've written about in your column, and a couple of days later there's an editorial that reflects a similar opinion or argument that you made in your column? Is that just a coincidence that they were struck by what you wrote, or is this some conspiracy within the paper to double hit people or double layout on issues?
If they cite me, then obviously they were inspired by something I had written to comment more on that subject. But sometimes it's just a coincidence. I mean, you know, an issue is hot in the news, and we're supposed to, you know, timeliness is one of
So there's no, like, communication going on. You're over here doing your
thing. No, on a different floor, different...
When you're on that floor, what are you doing? What are you reading? What are you reading that instructs you, that informs you, that leads you to make the judgments that you do in your columns? What do you pick up and read every day?
I mean, I am, you know, on the blogs, you know, Chronicle, all of the, I try to read as many people who don't like me as possible to know what the other side is, to know what the other side is thinking. But I don't, a little of everything. I mean, and it's, you know, sometimes you read so much about one subject and you don't even know where you read it. It's just kind of all together. But I love
the Chronicle columnists. You read the Chronicle columnists.
Yes.
You're the guests.
The
guest columnist, I'm thinking.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Okay.
You don't waste your time when he writes a guest column. I hope not. Let me ask you this.
Yeah.
What are you working on now? What are the things that we're going to see coming in the next couple of months?
I knew
Lisa
you were going
Falkenberg.
To ask me that, but I don't have a grand project this year. I haven't found one yet. So if any of you viewers out there, you know, have an idea. Actually, people are always sending in ideas, and I've kind of distracted lately. I haven't been up on my email. But, you know, there are things that have piqued my interest in the legislature and I focused on. Pre-K is very important to me. The truancy bill I haven't gotten around to writing about, but, you know, I really believe what happens in truancy, with truancy in this state, is appalling. Healthcare is really pressing right now. What's going on at Ben Taub, that is something I'd really like to tackle this year.
And you're talking about drive-by and the emergency.
Yes, room. I mean, we could lose, you know, our status. I mean, we have so few, you know, level one trauma care centers in this area, as we've written about recently. But I need to get on the ground. I need to get in the ER. I need to really spend some time, as much as HIPAA will let me, you know, talking to patients and seeing how this is affecting people over there. I remember in Dallas years ago, I did that at Parkland, and it's really illuminating. You can read as many statistics as you want and listen to all the, you know, the people in the medical center talking about pressing this issue is, but until you really talk to the patients and talk to the doctors and see what they're struggling with and the hospital beds, you know, lined up outside, then same thing with the grand jury. Unless you have a human story, a picture, an image that people can relate to.
Well, what about this? Let me recommend one for you.
Please
know,
do.
There's an excerpt from a columnist in the Chronicle today who asked the question. He's a professor of religious studies at UT. He says, and this is after the Waco shootings, whether we want to live in a society that is secure because everyone is ready to shoot one another, or that we live with peace of mind that guns have been regulated and controlled and our population disarmed. In other words, Waco is it's Colorado, it's Sandy Hook, it's everywhere. It's like a mass shooting every week of more than three people.
Right. They had things other than guns over there, didn't they? In the brawl.
It was guns ended up killing people.
Bikers. Well, it was bikers.
Yeah,
off.
You know.
That was a poignant question that the guy asked.
But I'm not talking about disarming. I think so many people think that that's what gun control means, that somebody's going to come and take away your guns.
Well, that's what David wants. But he wants to take away the guns from the law-abiding citizens because the criminals aren't giving them up. Unless the police forcibly take it from
them. And that's how we get to the Jade Helm and all this business, is the conspiracy theories. People who think that, first of all,
don't trust
even
government.
If that was the best thing to do, take away everybody's guns, we couldn't do it, okay?
Because the criminals won't give them up.
Well, the law-abiding people won't either, especially with Obama in the White House. So it's never going to happen.
So you're interested in
assault rifles are a different subject.
You are interested in criminal justice reform.
Yes.
All right. Nebraska just repealed the death penalty. I don't know whether you heard that. A number of southern states have penal reform that is being credited in the New York Times even. And Mississippi, Alabama, Georgia. Is there something that you think Texas should be doing that we're not doing in terms of criminal justice reform other than your grand jury proposal?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, there's a lot to do with, you know, making the system fairer as far as prosecutorial misconduct and making sure that prosecutors are held to some kind of standard. If they break the law, if they don't follow, you know, the Brady requirements for them to turn over evidence, what happens to them? Really, what happens to them? What kind of accountability have we seen? I mean, only Ken Anderson. He spent a few days in in jail for sending Michael Morton to prison for 25 years.
And I believe Mr. Sebesky's on trial.
Oh, no, he's not. The state bar is finally, not as far as I know, but the state bar is finally looking at him. But there you have Charles Sebesky sitting out there, still saying in Burleson County that Anthony Graves is guilty.
Final question, 15 seconds to go. Who is the conservative Lisa Falkenberg at the Chronicle?
Who's the conservative Lisa? Yeah. Well, seeing as how there's only one Metro columnist.
She's from Seguin.
I am from Seguin. I grew up in a very... Okay. Actually, you're making me feel very conservative today because I'm not biting on some of
Lisa,
these.
Lisa, thank you so much. You're a fun guest, and I hope you had a good time
Our best.
Great conversation. I wish we could go on longer. We look forward to your next columns, whatever they turn out to
thank
be.
You so much.
And congratulations. Thank you so much, Lisa. And remember, you can catch Red, White, and Blue every Friday at 7:30 p.m. right here on TV8, and again Saturdays at 6:30 p.m. We also invite you to visit us online and send us your comments. We want to hear what you are saying about the issues that affect Houston. You can submit your comments at HoustonPublicMedia.org or on Facebook. And while you're there, please don't forget to like us. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you again next week. Good night.